What I thought we would do today is place this in context with the Acts of the Apostles that we have been reflecting on. Remember, the most important person objectively in the early church was, of course, Saint Peter, the one whom Christ himself appointed to be the head of the church. Peter recognized from the very beginning how the Jewish people were not accepting the Messiah. In fact, it was for fear of the Jews that he, Peter, denied the Master. It was for fear of the Jews that the apostles hid themselves and were afraid of what might happen to them, which did happen to our Lord. On Pentecost Sunday, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, Peter spoke with such courage as he had never manifested before. And as we know from his sermon on Pentecost Sunday, Peter was outspokenly courageous, telling the Jews they had crucified the Messiah. His courage paid off, and some 3,000 were baptized on what is the birthday of the church as a social institution. The church, therefore, has two birthdays. The church was born on Calvary as the mystical body of Christ. But the church was born as the one who began to propagate herself, therefore, as a social institution on Pentecost Sunday. The moment the apostles began to evangelize, what happened to Jesus began to happen to them as a sheer carbon copy. The opposition that Jesus experienced from his own people, he began to experience in the person of his apostles and his dearest followers by being opposed, persecuted, and under the leadership of Saul, put to death. It is impossible to exaggerate the importance of seeing the Apostolic Church as reflecting in her life what happened to the Master. And after all these years in the priesthood, I never tire repeating to the people whom I'm either lecturing to or teaching, this is a law of Christianity, no less than Christ himself, so his followers inevitably, infallibly, are opposed, rejected, attempts made to silence, and then to wipe out. Been going on for 2,000 years, and the only mistake that we can make is to think, well, that somehow things have changed. They have not changed one iota. All that people do, how well I know, is compromise. Compromise with Christ's teaching. And then they are accepted by the world. Now the enemies in the first 3 centuries of the church's history, we may say that they were, well, the Roman emperors and the pagans of the Roman Empire. Externally, yes, but at root, no. At root, the genesis of the persecution of the church was the same Jewish people who had rejected Christ. And that is why Saul's conversion from Judaism is so crucial for understanding how the church, first of all, survived, indeed thrived, during those 3 centuries of persecution, and how the church, for now 2,000 years, has survived, and how she will thrive also in our century and the 21st century, which is approaching. The church survives and thrives only where there are still bishops, priests, and the laity that are thoroughly faithful to Jesus Christ and do not compromise with the world. And by now, in our country, we're living in a nation, and I say this to my sorrow, in a nation that is widely compromised with the teachings of Jesus Christ. And consequently, to still talk this language sounds either poetic or archaic, or at least unrealistic. But, and I hope I'm talking to the right audience, the only one that will survive as honest to God Christians are those who believe what the first Christians believed, that there was just no compromise with the world. Saul's conversion from Judaism teaches us how a man who was thoroughly devoted to the Jewish way of life, how that man had to have a series of miracles worked before he was converted. Now watch this. The conversion of St. Paul was not only that. He had to be converted by recognizing that Jesus was indeed the Messiah, which, as Saul, he did not believe. While Judaism so strongly stood for in Saul's day, and within Saul on conversion, saw so clearly that his 14 letters, you might say, have one theme, and that is, God became man to teach us the meaning of the cross. And that's just the opposite. That is just the opposite of what some 400 years before the coming of Christ, Judaism had become. The Messiah they were looking for was a Messiah who would indeed deliver the Jews, be their Savior. All the words remain the same: liberator, deliverer, Savior. The only question, but a crucial one, is Savior from what? For the Jews in Saul's day, the Messiah was to have been, so they expected, a Savior from the oppression, the opposition, even the enslavement by a political power which they had experienced for centuries before, but then reached its apex, the peak of Jewish, talk about anti-Semitism, Lord, it reached its peak under the Roman Empire. And Saul then had to learn the hardest lesson that not just he, but we have to learn. That God became man to save us indeed, but not to save us from the trials of this life, but save us from sin. And that is not pious poetry. What a difference. And that is why I thought that an hour or so on Judaism would be useful. I had thought of drawing on my own book, which I recommend. If you find a copy in a library somewhere, the book should be reprinted, but it's out of print, on American Judaism, published, I guess, some 20 years ago by Loyola University Press, American Judaism. I think every Catholic should understand something, and the more the better, about Judaism, written sympathetically by the people who gave us the Messiah. But to know who the Jews are, first then a definition. Judaism is the religious culture of a people who trace their roots to the Old Testament prophets and their hopes in a forthcoming Messiah. That's the standard Jewish definition of Judaism. And every word there counts. Notice, it is not precisely a religion. It is rather a religious culture. It is no mere culture, but a religious culture, which is absolutes, who trace their roots to the Old Testament prophets we don't know, but it is doubtful if there are any Jews on earth today that are direct descendants of Abraham. Maybe there are, but it is doubtful. But as a people, they trace their cultural roots then to the Old Testament prophets, and their hopes. So their past is rooted in Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and their hopes in a forthcoming Messiah. In other words, Judaism, with the strongest, clearest, most uncompromising faith that only a Jew can have, they not only do not believe that Jesus is the Messiah, they are outspoken, militantly outspoken. Jesus is not the Messiah. So true is this, that the Muslims who believe that Jesus was the Messiah, strange. Between, therefore, the Muslims and the Jews, there is no love lost, precisely because the Muslims do believe that Jesus was the Messiah, where the Jews are outspokenly, militantly against the Messiah having already come. Now, the rest of it, of Christianity, is essentially the religion started by Paul of Tarsus. Not know that is not to understand Judaism. It is Saul, or Paul, if you wish, of Tarsus, who broke the bond, so the Jews claim, who broke the bond that formerly united the chosen people and mistakenly urged the Jews to accept Jesus of Nazareth as their Messiah. And this, over the years of lecturing on Judaism, this is, you might say, infallible teaching in Judaism. It is Paul, who mistakenly introduced the idea that there was a man by the name of Jesus of Nazareth who should be followed. Now, whether and to what extent the Christians themselves believed that Jesus was the Messiah. At any rate, the Jews rejected it absolutely. Now, the origins of modern Judaism. First, the fall of Jerusalem under Titus, A.D. 70. I cannot tell you how detailed is their historian Josephus, that is the Jewish historian Josephus, in describing the fall of Jerusalem. After the Jews had crucified Jesus. They were further divided than they had ever been before. And for the next 35 years, to the year 70, they opposed the Romans with all the vehemence. In fact, never in Jewish history have the Jews been so militant. It is not just as though, but instinctively they felt, and correctly, that if they did not succeed in overthrowing the Roman Empire, this is the end of Judaism. And they were right. Not know that is not to understand Judaism. And of course, having their hearts set on the Messiah, who then disappointed them because they thought it was going to be Jesus. And once more, I cannot tell you how deeply this has shaped my life, what I'm sharing with you, has profoundly affected my whole life. The Jews rejected Jesus because they expected him to provide them with, well, a free and prosperous life here on earth. That was their vision of the Messiah. And so far, providing them with liberation from the Romans, he allowed himself to be crucified by the Romans. But you know, they shouted for his crucifixion. The same mistake, by the way, that Judas made. Volumes have been written about the mind of Judas. Judas symbolizes much more than we realize. He symbolized the Jewish mind. If he is indeed the Messiah, as the Jews understand the Messiah, well, I'll get 30 pieces of silver. The Messiah. Well, you make sure change of the Romans. He's the Messiah. You get the logic. For then one generation, the Jews just fought and resisted as the Romans had never before been resisted by any nation in 700 years of Roman history. Nobody, but nobody, had resisted the Romans the way the Jews did. And finally, the Romans figured, and they didn't want to do this. They didn't. But they figured they have no choice, the Romans. These are no ordinary people, and they were right, the Jews. There's only one way that we can crush this rebellion. You've got to wipe out the Jews. And they did. The Jews were wiped out as a nation. So then, the origins of modern Judaism, fall of Jerusalem, under Titus, Emperor Titus. The remnant There are two rabbinical schools, one in ancient Babylon, present Iran, and the other at Germania, present Tel Aviv. Now the one at Germania held a synod of the Pharisees in the year 100. And they were the ones who rewrote the Bible. I mean, really rewrote the Bible. They dropped seven books that for centuries the Jews had honored as the Word of God. And they retranslated from what had been the Hebrew into Greek, and among other things. And when I, for example, on the feast, well, yesterday, on the Feast of the Annunciation, I listened closely. By the way, Michael was doing the reading at Mass. Listen closely. What will the translation say? Will it be a virgin who will conceive and bear a son? Well, to the credit of the translators, the translation, at least in the lectionary, was, "A virgin shall conceive," 7th chapter, 14th verse of Isaiah. Well, the Jews who retranslated, they just changed everything. And they removed the word virgin from Isaiah. And now for over 400 years, all Protestants, poor dears, have been following the Jews. Oh no, oh no. And dropped the word virgin from Isaiah. Clunk. And the seven books which they dropped, these are the Jews, among the seven most important books of the Old Testament, especially the Book of Wisdom, which says so much about the second person of the Holy Trinity, the wisdom of God, the Word of God. In any case, they realized, the remnant of what was left of Israel, that Christianity is here to stay. And they're going to cope with it, and they're not going to be Christians. Do you hear me? We're not going to be Christians. Okay, that's settled. There are less than 20 million Jews in the whole world. But are they ever powerful? Extremely powerful. Now, the Talmud. The word itself literally means instructions. It contains basically two writings, so-called Mishnah and Gemara, going back to the 3rd century and the 6th century of the Christian era, by which time, is by the way, the Talmud was basically finished. The contents of the Talmud are really the interpretation of the Jewish law that goes back to before the time of Christ. Over the years, in lecturing on Judaism, which I have, my own edition that I've used is in 28 volumes, 28 volumes, about 2 inches thick, and each stands about 18 inches high and about a foot wide. And accumulatively, I would say at least 3 million words. Explanation of the laws of the Jews, most detailed, mainly emanating from the Pharisees. And the two aspects of Jewish life that are given most attention are the observance of the Sabbath and the dietary laws. All I can tell you, you read the Talmud and you thank God for being a Christian. And it is in the Talmud, it's in the Talmud that abortion is not only allowed, but described how it's to be done. And mind you, this goes back to early Christian history. And the foundation of the Talmud for abortion is that that child is not a person until it is born. Do you hear me? And that was the foundation of all the abortion laws in the United States emanating from the state of New York. The Talmud, though most people would hardly even know how to spell the word, has been profoundly influential in shaping the minds of hundreds of millions unwittingly because of the influence of the people who have over the centuries depended on the Talmud to govern their moral conduct. Now, Moses Maimonides, in class and have courses in Judaism, graduate courses in Judaism. I found it most useful in teaching the subject to have my students concentrate on what I consider the most developed and perceptive mind in Judaism, certainly in the Christian era, namely Moses Maimonides. You notice, born in 1135, and here are just 12 principles of Moses Maimonides' faith, which it is well to both identify and clarify. God is recognized as creator, that God is one. And of course, this would be in contrast with the Christian understanding of God as Trinity. Number three, and Maimonides, very forthright, God has no body. Am I clear? God has no body. In other words, the incarnation is absolutely and utterly rejected. God is the first and the last, the first from whom and the last for whom the world has been created. We are to pray only, and the word is only, to God, and never to anyone else. And the true prophets, but the insistence, these are the true prophets and no one else. Moses is the one prophet for everyone, including, of course, Christians. Torah is now the same. In other words, the Pentateuch, the first five books of the Bible, remain the same, binding on the whole human race as they were binding when they were first written at the dawn of Jewish history. God knows our thoughts. Of course, God rewards and punishes. Again, as Christians, we have no difficulty accepting that. But then 11, and this is crucial, the Messiah will come. He will come. In dealing with Jewish people, in teaching their persons, lecturing in their synagogues, I have found that there is one thing on which, if the person even remotely considers himself a Jew, they are adamant the Messiah has not yet come. For the Jew, this is absolute. And finally, for Maimonides, there is a resurrection from the dead. And to this day, among the Orthodox Jews, they call themselves, there is a resurrection from the dead. Now, so-called Kabbalism. A great deal of what goes by the name of Judaism is either pure Kabbalism, or at least tinged with Kabbalistic literature. As you can imagine, 2,000 years of Jewish history, having no authentic prophets to direct them, all kinds of ideas have penetrated the Jewish mind. And among the Jews, therefore, there are Kabbalists who are merely speculative, others again, who perform wonders, so they claim. And what we have to always keep in mind, we don't believe, we've said this, I think, in a class before, we do not believe that mysticism, no matter how we define it, that mysticism is either identical with or any sure sign of sanctity, indeed, even of orthodoxy. And it's when you get into areas like this that you can find among these people some marvelous things that are performed and which can mislead the unwary. In other words, mystical phenomena are not uncommon in Kabbalistic Judaism. Then the three main forms of Judaism in the modern world. First, the so-called Orthodox, from the first century AD, call it most conservative. The name, however, goes back to the 19th century when Napoleon was convinced the Jewish people were not a religion, but a form of politics. And so the Jews in France had to make a decision. And there were many Jews in France had to decide, are we a religion or are we a culture? And if we are a religion, what form of Judaism do we belong to? So they came up in the last century with this triple division. Though the beginnings go back, I say, to the first century, the structure as we now know it is only about 150 years old. Orthodoxy does not necessarily mean orthodoxy in doctrine, but rather orthodoxy in practice. In other words, for the Jew, and remember this, for the Jew, an Orthodox Jew is one who believes in the Torah, T-O-R-A-H, who believes in the law. The very word Orthodox is misleading. It is borrowed from Christian literature. Your orthodoxy for us means fidelity in doctrine to the teachings of Christ. For the Jews, orthodoxy is rather fidelity to the laws of Judaism. That's what Torah means in Judaism, law, as interpreted by the Pharisees. So an Orthodox Jew is one who is faithful to the laws, faithful in observing the Sabbath, faithful in keeping the dietary laws. Secondly, the reform. They were at the other extreme. So the two extremes in Judaism are Orthodox and Reform. Now, although the Reform wanted to be considered Jews, nevertheless, they are basically a culture. And they will use what they think is useful for their own purpose from Judaism, but they can be very cavalier in the observance of, say, Jewish laws. Yet over the years, I remember once having dinner with a Jewish couple and their daughter in Long Island. And they were very liberal as Reform. By the way, not Reformed, but Reform, as they could be, but partly to impress me, and partly to, well, express their conscience. The meal we ate was a kosher meal. As we sat down to eat the meal, the daughter said, "Now, you understand, the three of us are atheists." So I said, "Well, if you three are atheists, that means we've got to start with a prayer." How to win friends and influence people. So, great big sign of the cross, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, as loud as I could, "Bless us, O Lord, in these thy gifts, which we are about to receive from thy bounty, through Christ our Lord. Amen." In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. And now, you atheists, let's go on. We talk religion so long, I almost missed my train because it was an hour's drive back to Manhattan. You have a daughter who is a nun. And the father, this is about a month before, he took me out for dinner, the father did, to a saloon on First Avenue in Manhattan. And he sat down. I took some orange juice. He had several hard drinks. And he wanted you to prove to me that my daughter is not crazy. So he talked, did everything that I could to prove that his daughter was not crazy. And then we got on the same subject during this long dinner at their home. And I kept, on him. I kept trying to be convinced that she's not crazy. She's not crazy, I assure you. Well, why did she become a nun? Did you see how she's dressed? You can hardly even see her ankles. Well, I said, she's doing that because she wants to convert you. You're an atheist. That makes sense. That makes sense. So she's still working on them. Hasn't come around yet. So the reform, they're the other extreme. In between are the so-called conservative religion, but adapted to the times and the people. For the book on American Judaism that I was writing, I got my best cooperation from the conservative Jews, the rabbi, that I came to know quite well. Let me take pictures of his synagogue and so on. The others, they were not so, they just did not trust a Jesuit. Mm-hmm. So, but the conservative rabbi was very cooperative. I spoke to his congregation, just very openly, and told them about Christ and Mary. Now the ritual. There are many rituals, of course. I just thought I'd identify some of them. For the boys, of course, circumcision remains. Their bar mitzvah, when, again, the boy, is declared to have reached maturity, like we read in the Gospels, at the age of 12, a big celebration. And rabbis tell me, Father, the number of people that come to the bar mitzvah, but for some of them, it's the only time they come to the synagogue for the bar mitzvah. I can't get them to come again. At any rate, they're not always as faithful as they should be. And then the kiddushin, the mezuzah, the talith. What I should do, I think, and I've thought about this, I did have notes for this class. I thought to myself, I better not go into too much detail. What I might do is provide for next class. What time is our next class? What day is it?
Next week.
Is it?
Yes. Second. The study
for all. Is next Sunday? Okay. I might be able to photostat, make copies of some explanation of these terms for the next class. Know something more about the Jews. The Sabbath, of course, is the big feast day, which is, as you all know, Saturday. And the essence of Sabbath for the Jews is abstaining from work. Then it is well to know that the synagogue has really replaced the temple. And in fact, in talking to Jews, it hardly even occurs to them that the temple had disappeared. For 2,000 years, there has been no temple. And there is no Judaism without a temple. Israel, the country of Israel, has been in existence since 1948. It's taken almost 50 years. They built a temple. They just don't think of those terms. So the Sabbath and the synagogue are the two, you might say, main foci of the Jewish religion. And they have readings, prayers, chants, preaching, and rites. I might maybe photostat a page or two from a standard prayer book used in the synagogue. And they pray, O Savior, come. O Savior, come. O come. And in the Orthodox synagogues, the men will pray and thank God. Lord, we thank you for not making us women to this day. Anybody who thinks that discrimination against women is somehow part of Christianity just does not understand Christianity. It's just the opposite, just the opposite. All the discrimination, you name it, came from both paganism and, in this case, Judaism. Dietary laws. For example, sometimes when I am giving a retreat in a convent, I ask the sisters to find a can of whatever canned material they're using. And next time you're in your kitchen or in your pantry, you might look up. There's a U with a circle around it. That means it's guaranteed, approved by the Union of Orthodox Rabbis. An Orthodox Jew will not touch anything canned unless it has that label on it. Imagine Catholics putting labels on cans. But they do it. And the rabbis in these food factories standing right there watching how these things are done. And you better follow the directions, otherwise you don't get their business. No blood, and things that are forbidden, and again, no mixture of meat and milk. Over the years in eating kosher meals with Jews, it is fascinating. And of course, they may serve me a kosher meal, but I never hold back in telling them something about Christianity. In any case, then, in relation to the state of Israel, except for the United States, there will be no Israel in existence. And behind that, of course, stands a whole history of both our nation and the Jewish people. Pray, pray for the Jewish people. We have so much to thank them for, and they have so much that they still need. Thank you. How many steps are there for canonization of a saint? Basically three. The first step The first step is that their virtue is declared heroic. So the first step is heroicity of virtue. And that's the most important. Their lives are examined to prove that they did really practice extraordinary virtue. And one of the conditions for practicing heroic virtue is difficulty, suffering, and opposition. So, if you expect to be canonized, find some opposition. Second step is beatification. For that, you need miracles. Normally two, one with the dispensation. Our third step is then canonization. Again, more miracles. Step one, heroicity. Second, beatification. Third, canonization. Oh, pardon me. What are the steps to sainthood called in Latin? Well, heroicitas, beatificatio, and canonizatio. In fact, the English words are just derived from the Latin. Can you comment on the practice of a Catholic parish to host a Seder Passover meal in Holy Week? I don't like it. Seder, that's the Jewish Passover. As far as I know, this year, the Passover is on our Holy Saturday. Our Holy Saturday is the Jewish Passover this year. And the Passover Supper would be, well, before the Passover. I don't like it. I've never encouraged it. And I find it very hard to defend. Will the persecutor or persecution in the church increase, and will we survive past the year 2000? Well, I think we'll survive all right. So instructions. Ministry of Communion. Please consume after altar breath immediately on leaving chapel area after distribution of communion. Mystery, why are the rector altar breaths left over after communion? Ministers of welcome and sacristans, set of gold cups and dishes with altar prayers for next Mass. If there are extra consecrated hosts, they are placed on the altar table and covered with white linen purificators and left here until the next Mass. Well, not the best idea. It should be placed in the tabernacle. Next week, will you please bring three catechisms for me? I presume there are all kinds of catechisms. Is it three of my catechisms or three of the catechisms of the Catholic Church? Okay. When going to confession, when does the penitent say the act of contrition? Well, it should be after being given the penance by the priest. And then, after receiving the penance by the priest, the penitent should make the act of contrition, followed by the absolution. Please explain, there is no Judaism without a temple. Now, because that's what Judaism had been for centuries. In other words, the religion in which sacrifice was offered. Sacrifice was offered by the priests who were out of the priestly caste. In other words, there are priests in Judaism whose purpose is to offer sacrifice. That's the nature of Judaism. What is meant by the word Zionist? Well, in general, a Zionist would be a Jew who is strongly inclined to having Israel established as a political power. In fact, I would say behind the existence of Israel as a country now is the Zionist movement. In other words, the strong urge to have Israel established politically is Zionist movement. Has Akita, Japan been approved? I understand it has been approved by the local bishop in Japan. Have you heard or read the Protocols of Zion? Do you find it to be fact or fiction? I find it to be fiction. Has Gabriel Bussis been beatified, author of He and I? I would not know. Don't know. What do you think about the Catholic Charismatic Movement? This must be at least the 70th time that I've answered this. I think many very zealous and dedicated Catholics belong to the charismatic movement. I pray for them, and I have no difficulty with people belonging to the charismatic movement. But as a charismatic movement, I distinguish between the origins of the movement and its present membership organization. the origins of the movement are Protestants. Going back to John Wesley, who started Methodism and the Holiness Movement among the Protestants. In other words, the charismatic movement in its historical origins is Protestant. And of course, since I love Protestants, I have no difficulty, but I have to repeat, I distinguish between people belonging to the charismatic movement and its historical foundations. Are the Toshua books, Father Kirzon, true to Orthodox Catholic? Joshua books.
He was in the diocese this Friday.
Sure. Joshua, in our parishes, St. John the Evangelist, Davidson, and whose father, Joseph Kirzon, author of the Joshua series of books, at 7 p.m. Friday at the Church of Father Kirzon, we present insights into the person of Jesus. There is no admission charge, but a ticket is required. Send a self-addressed stamped envelope. So, and then noted Joshua author to speak in Davidson. Father Joseph Kirzon, by the way, you pronounce his name, Kirzon. Popular author of the Joshua books, a share a portrait of Jesus, Pravedi, his personal leader God. Father Joseph Kirzon is not to be trusted. He is a very, very dangerous person. I repeat, he is a very dangerous person.
Repeat the name.
What was the name? Joseph Kirzon, G-R-I-Z-O-N-E. Can you recommend an examination of your conscience, especially for teens? What I can do by next week, are we meeting next Sunday? Make sure you remind me to bring an examination of conscience. We have one, hope also one suitable for teens. Thank you. What book outside of the Catechism and Bible would you recommend regarding the sin against the sixth commandment? Let me do that again also next Sunday. The one book that I have in mind, I'm afraid is out of print, which is a good book, but I'm afraid it's out of print. See if you can find one, a good, popular book that is still in print. Carol, would you please remind me? Do you think Thomas A. Dooley should be considered for canonization? I find his life very inspirational. Thomas A. Dooley.
He was a doctor in the Far East.
Was he a doctor?
Medical doctor in the Far East.
Vietnam.
Yes. Yes, in fact, he has died, hasn't he? Has he died? Yes. I knew him personally. Yes. Yes. It would be well, I think, if his cause were introduced for canonization. But as you also know, to be canonized, somebody's got to promote your canonization.
So.
Our church is hosting a program called Roman Spirituality. They ask us to hear voices of the past, meditate on is it Lilith or is it a myth and much more. I read Ungodly Rage by Donna Steichen regarding the feminist movement within the Catholic Church. I know what they are teaching is wrong. I'm there to spy. Have you heard of this book? What do I do now that I have proof? Catholic Social Services is a promoter. Well, I would say continue spying. Of course, don't call it spying. You're there on a private mission. And either take notes, or if you can get a recording, that would help. And there are ways in which this can be brought to the attention of people who can't do something. There is just a lot of this mythology going around and doing a great deal of harm to many people. Is that the end now? My daughter was married 2 years ago to a man that attends the Assembly of God. He was not baptized when they were married. He was baptized last year at Assembly of God. They were married in the Catholic Church. He is considered sacramental. Well, it depends on how the baptism was performed. Now, some Assemblies of God baptize collectively. For example, a number of people will be immersed in water, and someone on the, say, on the shore will be pronouncing the words of baptism. In any case, would help, but it would be necessary to know how the baptism was performed. Not all Assemblies of God believe in the Holy Trinity. And consequently, was the man baptized in the name of the Holy Trinity? That would be important. Moreover, presumably, the wedding before he was baptized, from what I gather. One of the conditions for a valid marriage with a person who is of another religion is that there be the assurance that both the Catholic partner will not be jeopardized in the practice of his or her religion, and that all the children will be raised as Catholics. Moreover, there must be the assurance that contraception would not be practiced. So then, raising the children as Catholic, not jeopardizing the faith of the Catholic partner, and not practicing contraception are conditions for a valid marriage. Here's a quotation. Like all the sacraments, the anointing of the sick benefits us only if we approach it in faith. We should never delay reaching out on the occasion of sickness, to seek the consolation in the presence of Jesus, the divine healer. Well, approach it in faith. It depends on what the person means. An unconscious person, as I think we've said before, an unconscious person can be validly anointed. There must have been valid baptism, otherwise no anointing. There must be sufficient faith between the time of having, say, sinned and the anointing, even though the person now is unconscious, to be sorry for having offended God, at least out of fear. But is not precisely the faith that produces the effects in anointing. It's the sacrament where faith is presumed. Could you explain the rule in the Vatican II documents on the method of receiving Holy Communion? When may a person kneel? Does a pastor of a parish have the right to insist that everyone stand? No. Having said that, your question is, where do we go from there? Only God knows, only He knows, what has happened to the faith of thousands of people. In other words, for those who insist that communion not be received kneeling, for those who insist, whether priests or otherwise, the question is, do they still believe in the real presence? So the answer is no. As a pastor of a parish, does any priest? No. Does a deacon? No. Does an extraordinary minister have a right to insist that everyone stand? No. And oh, no. But having said that, and this is what we were talking about, remember, talking about this being the age of martyrs and witnessing to the faith, look, we're not talking tiddlywinks. We're not playing with words. This is real. It is honest to God real. It is real. Now, in any given instance, say where the pastor, wherever it is, would insist that a person stand. Well, it could be, and I've heard of some horrendous scenes that a priest, my God, have mercy on him, objectively, and I mean I know I'm being taped, when a priest would insist that somebody going to communion stand and not kneel, objectively, and I watch my words, I consider that a grave sin on the part of the priest. Do you hear me? But so many priests are so poorly, what a weak term, so badly educated. God knows. I've seen the textbooks used in some seminaries. It's no wonder some just don't know their faith. So in a given case, have them make a scene, or then stand. Not to make a big issue of it, but then find a priest or go, you know where it is. You will not be subjected to this kind of harassment. 25 years in working with ODC, as I keep telling you people, it's taught me an awful lot. Oh, what I couldn't tell you, what I'm seeing is just the tip of the tip. The revolution of the church is very deep. The loss of faith is widespread. That's why I'm here. Hopefully to strengthen your faith. Father Coughlin said that anti-Semitism is a hoax of a word, as most Arabs are Semites. Do you agree? Yes. Do you think Father Coughlin was anti-Semitic, or was he labeled such to discredit him? No. No. He was not anti-Semitic. My gosh. The Arabic people are Semites. Have you read the book Philip II by Thomas Walsh? Do you feel understanding of the role the Jews played in this time period is accurate? Do you recommend his books on history? Oh, yes. Thomas Walsh, by all means. Any books by Thomas Walsh, get your hands on. If the church ever extended women or intended women to participate in serving Holy Mass, as in reading the epistles or as altar servers, then why did our Holy Father give the permission for the use of altar girls? The only explanation that I can give is horrendous pressure from bishops in countries like America. Horrendous pressure. Please tell us, home educating parents, what we should do about college for our children. Do you feel it is necessary for them to go on to higher education, or should we be preparing them for skilled trades? Some people feel their children will never reach their highest potential without this opportunity. Maybe reread the last sentence. Some people feel that their children will never reach their highest potential without this opportunity of, say, college education. Well, people who feel this way about their children are mistaken. I have had my share, have I ever, of higher education. 16 years before I entered the Society of Jesus, and 15 more years, 31 years, mamma mia. There are some, of course, for whom, well, the college education is, I don't say necessary, but useful. But among the myths, and it is a myth, is that every able-bodied and able-minded American should have a college education. No. And one reason, among others, is that there are so few places in our country where you can get a good, sound Catholic education, even a sound secular education today on the college level. And it costs a fortune, a fortune. You talk this way to most people, they think you're, my gosh, you're anti-intellectual. My 5 years of teaching at Western Michigan, over 2,000 students I taught, and by law, 50% women, 50% men. How many of the students their senior year would come to me? Both men, but especially women. I don't know why I ever went to college. Now those that came to get an MRS degree, now that makes sense. That makes sense. And being on the faculty all my life, been on college faculties, I know the teachers. How well I know the teachers. Does a person who repeats a particular venial sin often enough, does he or does the matter change from venial to mortal? For example, impure thoughts. Well, in matters of chastity, as we say in theology, there is no poverty of matter. In other words, in matters of chastity, if a sin, whether even in thought or desire, is fully, consciously deliberate, is a grave sin. Fully and consciously deliberate and consented to. So the only question then is, whether it's an internal sin, like in thought or desire, or external with the body, whether a person was fully awake, fully conscious, fully consented, if the answer is yes, then there's just no arguing that there is a grave sin. It is a fact, not widely known, that the present Jews, the descendants of the as it says, the colors, what is the difference between Judaism and Zionism? Well, as I said before, Zionism is that form of Judaism in which the people, for political reasons, want, first they wanted, past tense, to establish Israel as a nation. They did, but only at the cost of disfranchising many Arab people. Arab people had to be disfranchised of their land, and they were. And the lowest figure every year is $2 billion support from America every year. That's the lowest every year. Praying, active contrition in confession. Our priest begins absolution after I've started praying the act of contrition. And during my prayer yesterday, I went to a different parish. This priest told me I should say the act of contrition before entering confessional? What should I say to these priests? Well, look, you got to get absolution, so don't argue with them. First of all, even if you did not verbalize an act of contrition, the very fact that you've come to confessional, it already is an implicit contrition. So to be safe, make an act of contrition before you come to confession. And then listen. And if you see he's already starting his absolution, well, you want to make your act of contrition. By the way, I've had to do this myself. So I can say this when I'm the penitent. And because afterwards, the priest that I could go to, they get used to me. So I put my hand up and tell him to hold off until I'm finished. But when they insist, then quietly, kind of under my breath, it's good to have maybe two or even three formulas for the act of contrition. You follow me? A real short formula. You can say, you know, quickly, and finish it while under your breath while he's giving you the absolution. But strictly speaking, the confession is good and valid, even though he doesn't give you time to make an act of contrition. But don't argue with the priest, especially if you want to go back to confession then. What does Jewish theology or ideas teach about Jesus? Well, they all, without exception, they all deny that Jesus was the Messiah, all of them. They all deny Jesus' divinity, all of them, no exceptions. They differ in their interpretation. The most common position, as I explained, was to claim that St. Paul, notice, St. Paul, they don't claim that Jesus was the one. Get the logic? It's Paul who got the bright idea that Jesus was the Messiah. And of course, there's no love lost among the Jews for St. Paul. Can a Pausian girl who I know died practicing heroic virtue and love be canonized? Sorry. No. No.
Why?
Did you see why? Well, first reason, because even though in your judgment, she practiced heroic virtue, but the Catholic Church has got a pass judgment on heroicity. And the Catholic Church's judgment on heroicity is what matters in canonizing a person. So, now, a person may be professedly a Protestant, but in many ways, may be in effect a Catholic in so many other ways. In other words, it is the Catholicity even among Protestants, which enables them to practice, say, extraordinary virtue. And above all, their faith in Jesus Christ as the Son of God. So, I think that's it, right? Thank you. Now, for next time then, let me look at my catechism, please. I've asked you to read the Parshvi Dot cover in class on the Sacrament of Penance, and read carefully what we did not quite finish. Then, for next class, we'll have the anointing of the sick. Which is pages 128, that's in your compendium of the Catechism, 128, 129, and 130. Chapter 12 on Peter, and the 13th chapter on Paul's first missionary journey. So chapters 12 and 13 of the Acts, okay? So the anointing of the sick and chapters 12 and 13 of the Acts. Shall we pray? In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. O Mary, conceived without sin, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.